Shabbat Shalom. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Glad to be with you. And let's start by humbling our hearts and bending our knees and being led to the throne of grace by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen. Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege to be here, for the mercies that brought us through the night and woke us up this morning and gave us the portions of health and strength, soundness of mind and body that you've given us, and imbued in our spirits the willingness to be here and fellowship one with another and all together. We thank you for this privilege and this opportunity. We pray that your divine will be accomplished and that we will immerse ourselves in this little season of presentation in a way that is pleasing to thee. Let your spirit rest, rule, and abide in our hearts according to thy will. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus, we pray, let us say, amen.
Amen.
Preparing for the end. Now, I thought of a few titles and all of that, and what would I present and what would I say to you today? Hopefully it will be what the Lord wants me to present. I thought about something that I have known for several decades, somebody who is special to me. And I was told this many years ago, and the sun is always darkest just before the dawn. And that's where I want to focus on today, that where we are now and where we are headed. But we do this in the inspiration of what the outcome will be. We're preparing for the end. But in preparing for the end, we are also getting ready for the beginning, the everlasting beginning, the kingdom to come. And so that's where I want to focus today. It's always darkest just before the dawn. For a scriptural perspective, let's look at John, Gospel of John 16, verse 33. The Gospel of John, chapter 16, verse 33. The last verse in chapter 16. Let's read it together. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. God has told us, says, while we're in this present world, we're going to have tribulation. All they that believe in God, all they that trust in God, they're going to suffer. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord will what? Deliver out of them all. We will have our season of trials and tribulations. We do. I don't know if a person's not having trials or tribulations. God's told us this, right? Everybody in here that doesn't have trials and tribulations, raise your hand. We are all dealing with various things. But the good thing is God knows everybody's trials. He knows everybody's tribulations, and he knows what the answer will be, and he knows when the answer will come. And he imbues us with the patience and long-suffering to wait until that answer comes. And it tells us that in due season, that's something that I really thought about it sometimes, in due season. Do you know when in due season is? At the proper time. At the full time. Due season is not when we want them. Due season is when God wills for it to be. And one of the key components I want to talk about today is the need for patience. Because this is a world of impatience.
Patience of the saints.
Mm-hmm. This is a world of impatience. Everything in every facet of it, if you think about it, so many people that are so impatient about the time, what we need to do, how we need to do it, and went, you know, all of those things. Constantly we are faced with impatience in this world, family, friends, and neighbors. And sometimes, unfortunately, you know me, a little bit of rough stuff coming. But and sometimes even among brothers and sisters, not only of the flesh, but of the spirit. So patience is really important. Now, along with that, and it tells us, as in the world you should have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. When we're talking about preparing for the end of the world, we're not talking about preparing the way that we might think. He has told us, lean not unto thine own understanding, but in all thy ways, what? Acknowledge him, and he will direct our paths. We don't have to worry about how we're going to go through or what we, you know, what we're going to deal with and how we're going to answer it. Those plans have already been made and are ready and waiting as we go through this time of preparing for the end. So I'm more concerned about our state of mind as we're going through it, and the necessity to let go of ourselves, and as the expression says, let God. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Let go of ourselves. Our inspiration comes from the cross itself. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. As we are in the process and in the preparation time going toward the end, have we said in our heart, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Which way shall we go through preparing for the end? Our way, his way. And that's something we have, that discernment we have to ask for and pray for every day. Isaiah 55, what does it tell us? It says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts. The way that we think we might need to go through it, we'll go through it, and the way God intends for us to go through it, do not necessarily have to be the same thing. And I want us to grasp that. The inspirational text, let's turn to 2 Peter chapter 1, and verse 21.
You like the last
verse. I kind of got a tendency for that this morning. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 21. There's a reason why it'll become apparent in a minute, few moments. But let's read that together. For the prophecy came not in the old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. You get the theme there. It says it came not, it says for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man. Then, and it shouldn't be now either. But holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And my question is simply this, who's moving you today? Don't answer it out loud, just kind of meditate on it. Think about it within yourself. But who and what is moving us today? The criticality of studying. Not for the sake of just studying, but what are we going to get out of studying? The importance of making sure we get the right message. Because, quote unquote, you read the message does not mean that you actually get the message. Now, I'm going to say that one more time. I don't know if y'all are going to get it or not. Hopefully. Because you got the message doesn't mean that you necessarily that you will get the message. How do we get the message? I'll give you a clue. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit. We must rightfully discern what the message is telling us. And let's not forget our title, It's Always Darkest Just Before the Dawn. It's already told us, and I've already said about persecutions and afflictions and all of those things. But if our minds don't get the message from the message, what will happen? Mm-hmm. We must get the message from the message. Many multitudes got Bibles, but have they got the message? Mm-mm. And personally, I pray that we all have the message.
Amen.
We are in a time of prophecy. What is prophecy?
History foretold.
Yeah. What else? Anybody else got a definition for prophecy? I got one that hopefully it'll make all of us think. One word.
Things that are ordained by God.
It begins with an R and ends with an N.
Revelation.
That is what prophecy does. What does prophecy, those who prophesied, what did they do?
Reveal.
They reveal what was what? Huh? What was coming. They reveal what was coming. So when we're talking about, we're in a time of prophecy, isn't it a joy to know that God is revealing to us what's coming?
Amen.
And how it's coming? And being in this time of prophecy, and the end time of prophecy, of all prophecy. We've had prophecy for thousands of years, haven't we? Mm-hmm. But this end time prophecy, because it is essential and necessary, because I truly and honestly believe we are in the end time.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. We are there. And so it's critical for us to understand and get the message that prophecy is revealing to us. I think about what it says, where it says, rightfully discerning the truth. You know what I'm talking about?
Timothy 2:15.
Yep. Rightfully discerning the truth. And the first time I read it, I said, what do you mean? If you read it, you've got to get it. No, you don't. Rightfully discerning the truth. When you talk about history, human history, but in particular, biblical history, we're talking about what? Discerning, getting the understanding, getting the wisdom of knowing what all these are. There's nothing that there is not a rationale and an understanding for. But the problem is this. What did I tell you about this? This is the message. But do we get the message? This is the message, but do we get the message? And most importantly, do we get the message now? Going on into the what? The end time, the prophecy for this time. Do we get the message? Let's look at Philippians chapter 3. In verses 14 and 15. Verses 14 and 15, you can read with me, I hope you will. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded, and if in anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. What we need now is revelation. We need revealing. We need the understanding of prophecy. We need to, and I'll keep going back to it and back to it. As the expression says, you throw enough mud up against the wall, some of it might stick. But we need the revelation. And I like what it says at the beginning of verse 14, I press toward the mark. What mark are we pressing toward? The end. The end of this present world, the beginning of the everlasting kingdom, and I slowly, hour by hour, day by day, week by week, journey through this end time. This is a special time, and we ought to be especially committed. Y'all know, you understand what I'm saying? We ought to be especially committed. I'm not saying you aren't committed, but for now and this time, we need to be especially committed. If we never gotten it before, we surely need to get it now. It is critically important. Let's talk about, just for a minute, procrastination. Life brings its issues, doesn't it? It's always you got to do this and you got to do that, whatever. I can't remember the last time, every day of my life, I can't remember the last time that something didn't go amiss or something didn't get, was forgotten. I can't remember the last time I didn't do that. I'm always, quote unquote, forgetting something. Do I mean to do it? No. But it happens anyway. Life is full of demands, isn't it? For your time and your effort and your sacrifice. But the most important thing is that we use our time wisely. Do not answer this question out loud. Do we or do I procrastinate? Do we use every moment, every second, every minute as wisely, and every hour as wisely as we should? I know you're using it well, but is it possible that we can use it even better? How much thought do we give to this time right now? It's precious. And how am I using it? And how can I use it better? Lord, will you reveal to me how to use it even better? How often do we sit down and review ourselves? Am I wasting time? That's the most precious thing I have. Psalm 90, and somewhere around verse 14. We won't spend time going back there, but basically, and I'm pretty sure everybody in here knows it. It says, teach us to what?
Pray.
And what else? Something about days. Teach us to number our days. In other words, what? Understand the preciousness of time, the most important thing that we have. How many of us reflect on that every day? The most important thing that I have is time, and am I using every moment of it wisely? And you say, well, why all of that? Because eternity is hanging in the difference. It's hanging in the difference. Procrastinating. And sometimes we deceive ourselves that we're procrastinating righteously. Do y'all understand that? We're procrastinating righteously. I'm not talking about y'all. I'm talking about us. Do y'all get that? I'm not talking about y'all. I'm talking about us. Numbering our days, knowing and understanding the preciousness of time. Knowing and understanding the preciousness of every word that we say. The preciousness of every thought that we think. And the preciousness of every deed that we do. Do we need to be more circumspect about the most precious gift that we have? Time. Mm-hmm. I mean, if we got a few pennies in the bank, we keep up with that pretty good, don't we? In light of today's economic climate, we do that, don't we? The things that are near and dear to us, the most precious to us, that's where we're going to invest our time. Who and what is most precious to us? And in this hour, see, what I want to do is plant a little seed. I don't want you, quote unquote, to get it right here, right now, in this hour. I want you to plant some seed so it'll germinate. So even when you leave here, in that spiritual germination process, you'll think about some of the things I've said. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, you won't look at time the way you have. And however you're using it and how wisely you're using it, the probability is that we can what? Use it even better. And if anybody, we need to search, who is it? According to Psalm 139, right at the very end of it.
Search me, O God.
Mm-hmm. Search us. What am I doing with time? We can look all around us and find issues about other people and how they're using their time, but how many times do we look circumspectly at the time that we have and what we are doing with it? Who and what do we prioritize every minute, every moment of the day? We can all improve, can't we? We can all look at it and do better than we are already doing. Isaiah, like I said, 55:6, and I want to spend a little more time than I have on that. Isaiah 55. Sometimes I look at myself and I go to work and I come home from work and sit down for a few minutes and this and that, and I got to know what's going on and whatever, and before it, I know it's time to go to bed. And sometimes I reflect, what the hell have I done with time today? How did it get away from me? It didn't run, you let it get away. It didn't have legs to run away from you. Isaiah 55, beginning of verse 6. It says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Use your time preciously. Call ye upon him while he is near. And as we approach the time, actually going through the time of the end, how much of a priority is time to us? He says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. There is a time when we won't be able to find him, even if we want to seek him. And it says, call ye upon him, what? While he is near. That's about time. While he is there. The implication of the word while is that it has a time factor. Verse 7, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And but the only thing I have to say is that don't let wicked people take your time away from you when you could be using it more righteously. It says, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will what? Abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are what? Your ways, my ways, saith the Lord. That's why I was talking about how we use time and the preciousness of it and how we use it versus how we ought to use it. The way we use time and the way we ought to use it, is it like this or is it like this? There's some disparity there. The way we actually do use time and the way that we ought to use time, is it on this plane or is it like this? Y'all following along with me? What is it? Let's read a little further. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. I'm going to do this again. Now I want you to watch closely. What am I doing there? What did I just read?
You're getting your thoughts in line with his thoughts.
Are coming up to the level of what? Here we are. Here's slowly, gradually. Is that what we're doing every day? Is that the inspiration of our lives? Just think, I don't want you to answer out loud, but just think, just some food for thought. For as the rain cometh down, and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. The first thing I heard this morning, other than a few car strands straying through, was the sound of birds singing and rejoicing. And I thought about birds and how they live their lives. They're taking every moment of it and enjoying it to the fullest. Are we taking our time that we have, that God gives us every day and every hour of the day, and are we enjoying it to the fullest?
God provides for them.
Let me put it to you this way. In a human form, are we singing like birds do? Y'all know what I'm talking about? At the first sign, any hint of daylight, the birds begin to sing. And their song is joyful. In other words, I can wait till it gets a little light and then I'll start singing my song. They don't think like it. At the slightest hint of moment, they are thankful for their lives. They're living it to the fullest, and they're seeing it. They take in advantage of every moment of light, daylight, that they possibly can. So I let that be a reminder. More than likely, wherever you go back to, you got birds there. And hopefully when you hear these birds singing, that will trigger something in you, says, I need to be using my time wisely. We waste so much time. Sometimes we waste so much time until we see it getting near an end. Then it becomes as precious as it should have been all the time to us. In verse 11, so shall my word, let me rephrase it, so shall my thinking. Y'all get it? So shall my word, God is speaking here, his word, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. That was pleasantness to hear those birds singing this morning. And how often during the day is there pleasantness in those around you, from you? How often? How often do we set the tone and encourage others, not only ourselves, be encouraged ourselves, but to encourage others about the preciousness of time? Sometimes in our lives, we talk about the world, but sometimes I wonder if we're just like it. Gotta be, gotta go, gotta do, and gotta have it. We need to get our goddess straight. We need to prioritize them about who's who and what's what and when. It says, it shall not return unto me void. In other words, if you're using your time righteously, it's an investment, and there ought to be what? Return on investment. Do you understand what I'm saying when I say return on investment? In other words, when you send something out, it needs to be what? Something coming back. When the parable where he gave them these talents and things, and he wanted them to what? Invest them and return on an investment, and he was most displeased with who?
Lazy.
Didn't invest. Hey, I'm going to just stick mine in the ground and then bring it back to you. Are you, who have been given life, and me, who have been given life, are we to take the blessing that we have been given and just quote unquote stick it in the ground and just bring it back to him? When we come before him again, we ought to be worn out. Now, why am I saying it? We ought to be worn out because we have taken the investment that God has given us and we have used it to the fullest. Amen. And there's nothing left. I'm worn out, Lord, because you told me to go out into the world and preach the gospel. You told me to be a living testimony. And now, in the time of the end, I am worn out. How many of us are honestly worn out the righteous way? How many? Think. Remember what I told you? I'm planting seed. You're going to finish this sermon many miles from here. You're going to finish this sermon in the way that you live your life the rest of your life. The beginning of this sermon is today. From now on, it's going to get into the core of the meat of it and the end of it. The way that you live your life. So in a sense, what I'm saying is this. I'm the hopefully, by the grace of God, the seed planter. But I'm not the harvester. Y'all understand what I'm talking about? I'm the seed planter, but I am not the harvester. God has given me seed, I believe, and I'm trying my best to plant that seed, but I am not the harvester. Sometimes we are so worried about the harvest that we don't put enough focus on seed planting. So I'm going to read verses that we're going to finish it this time. So shall my word be that goeth out forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which what? I please. Who? God pleases. Not what? Quote unquote, I please, but what God pleases. I love, that's one of my favorite verses. In a sense, I shouldn't say that, all of them from Genesis to Revelation, but one that really touches me is where Paul said, I live, but nevertheless, not I, but Christ is living in me. And what I need to be is fertile ground that he can plant his love and his wisdom, amen, and his understanding, and his empowerment in me. And it shall prosper in the thing whereto I send it. What does that mean? You probably read this verse many times, haven't you? How many of you read this verse many times? But that part it says, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I send it. Did you meditate on it a little bit?
His word shall prosper.
But has it prospered in us? In the thing whereto I send it. I know what we think, but that's why he said, lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct our paths. We're going, but who's directing our path? That's just a question. Don't answer that loud. So let's move on a little bit. Who and what is the priority of our lives? Oh, when I get up in the morning, first thing in the morning, I talk to God. When I go to bed at night, I talk to God. Okay, don't answer this out loud. What's going on between morning and night?
His protection.
But what's going on in us? From that morning when we got up with God, and that night where we went to bed with God, but what has been going on all day long? Righteous use of the time God blessed me with, right? Hopefully. And it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Are you prospering in the thing whereto he has sent you? Is he prospering in the fact that he has sent, given me life? Is he prospering? Is his name being praised, honored, and glorified? I once said it here, and I think I'll say it again. If you were indicted for believing in God, could you be convicted? I want you to think about that one. If you were indicted for believing in God, is there enough evidence in your life, in every day of your life, for you to be convicted? In other words, when the prosecutorial perspective lays out the case, can he lay out this and that and the other and multiple times of every day that you live your life so that you can be convicted? That's one thing all of us ought to be prioritized to do what? To be convicted, to be found guilty. Okay, Hebrews chapter 12. In verse 1, read with me, please. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Did I say something about patience in this message today? Mm-hmm. Did I talk about sin? And that we struggle with it sometimes. Now, the one thing I might not have said anything about is this. Our priority is not what everybody around us is doing. Oh, it's good. They doing this and they doing that. That has nothing to do with you. What are you doing? Mm-hmm. They doing wonderful things. But that's not your issue. Your issue is what are you doing? Mm-hmm. We have wonderful people preaching the gospel, but what are you preaching in the living of your lives? We're all ministering in various ways. We're all reaching out to somebody that nobody else can get to in various ways. But in that cloud of witnesses, have we the inspiration, as it says next, let us lay aside every weight. You're a little heavier this morning than you ought to be. Am I a little heavier this morning than I ought to be? Mm-hmm. If there's still some weight I need to lay aside, I know I'm going to get a witness from the ladies. We all think what? I don't care. I've seen them as thin as pencils. I got to lose weight. And I'm thinking to myself, there's something wrong with this picture, Lord. But it says, let us lay aside every weight. Do you weigh a little more than you ought to today, this morning? Have you laid aside every weight? Probably you've laid aside most weight, but is there still a pound, spiritual pound or two that we need to lose? Okay, and the sin which doth so easily beset us. I wouldn't even go there for it. I'll say the temptation that is so easily besetting you. Remember, there's somebody else in here. Brother Fred, you brought it out about Satan. What is he doing? Even this hour and this minute. He's walking about. Like a roaring lion, doing what? Seeking whom he can devour. His mission, every moment of every day, is to what? Kill, to steal, and destroy. Do you believe, now Brother Fred did a great job of that, do you really think that Satan is taking some time off and saying, or do you think he's procrastinating and saying, I'll get to him or her or them later?
Not for a second.
Not for a moment. He's constantly at it to kill, to steal, and destroy. And we ought to be constantly at it to glorify the name of God. And we need to be willing to lay aside every weight. Now, this is tough, because sometimes that weight is a person. Matthew 10, he did love of who? More than me is what? It's not worry of me. We need to be laying aside weight. And I'm not saying it's an easy thing to do. Now, I'm a man that has a multitude of children in his life, but I never, quote unquote, been a biological father. So I can't say. But I will say this. There's weight in our lives that we need to lose. All of us. Every last one of us. He said, see that ye walk circumspectly. And let's stop telling everybody else you need to lose some weight. I need to lose some weight. Not y'all. I need to lose some weight. And let us run with what? What did I talk about in the beginning? Patience. The race, what? That is said, but what race is that? Marching toward what? The time of the end. We're in it now. We're running this race toward the time of the end. Why are we running? And now we're getting down to the culmination of this message. And I started with the title, It's Always Darkest Just Before the Dawn. Affliction coming, folks. Suffering coming. Heartaches coming. Grief's coming. But the word tells me, whatever comes, keep running this race. Mm-hmm. All of these things are coming. God has revealed to us. He has prophesied to us and used certain of us to prophesy to us that in this time of the end, we are to what? As the song says, hold fast to the blood-stained banner. Be prepared to go through all kinds of afflictions. I'm not going to read it to you now, but look again at Hebrews 11. Reflect upon what you find there, from the beginning of it to the end of it. And somewhere around verse 25 it says, we can either have sin for a season or we can choose affliction with the children of God. What shall we have? Do we run this race with hope? And I don't care how dark it gets. It's just the prelude to the eternal day. We talked about it, and I think Sister McCrillis back there, Dorothy, and I sitting back there having a little conversation, and we talked about it. The things that have to be accomplished in the order that they have to be accomplished in before this can happen. Before we can obtain the eternal day, we have to run this race. And it's dark, and it's foreboding, and it will dishearten and discourage you in every way. Satan attacking you, do you think he's going to come light or come heavy? What are you most sensitive to? He knows. Who is it and what is it that is in your life that he knows how it affects you? When he comes, he come in heavy duty. I'm reminded of World War II and the invasions of the islands when America was at war with both Japan and Germany. I just want to focus on Japan for a moment. When they attacked those islands, because I like to study the history of what happens and why it happens and why do people do these kind of things that cause so many souls to be lost, maybe. And when they got ready to invade those islands, before they actually released the men to go to the islands, they would bring in the guns. And I'm not telling you, they weren't using BB guns. Some of the shells were nearly half the size of us. And they sent those shells They were so powerful. Those shells could be sent anywhere 14, 15, 18, 20 miles. They had to have machinery to even put the shells, because they were so big and heavy, into the guns. In other words, when they got ready to invade an island, they came with the heavy stuff. My point is this, spiritually, Satan is coming with the heavy stuff. He's coming at you with who and what is most sensitive to you. And as we are going through this time of the end, we need to be reminded that I don't care how dark it gets, we are approaching, even more so as we're going through this time, the end time. And when the end time comes and it is over, then the beginning of eternity, the new day, the eternal day. We're going to persecution. We're going to tribulation. And I go back to what I said, that it's always darkest just before the dawn. Now, I want you to go turn back to Peter, 2 Peter, chapter 1. And I want you to go back to verse 19. See, I gave you 21, but I want to give you the other two verses that I wanted with you before we conclude. We have also a more, what? Sure word of prophecy, of revelation, of understanding, knowing what the priorities are. Whereunto ye do well that you take what? Heed. Not me, but God. I don't want you, if you don't want to pay a word attention to a word I said, well and good, but pay attention to God. Pay attention to his word. Whereunto ye do well that you take heed as unto a what? A light that shineth in a dark place. As we approach, as we are going through this time of the end, it's going to be dark. It says, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place. But the light of God is always going to be the guiding light that we can go through this time of darkness with. Mm-hmm. Until what? The day dawn is coming. And it mentions it in this way. It says, and the day star arise in your hearts. Who is in your heart? Who? Still throwing mud, Dennis. Yes, I am. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any what? Private interpretation. If you want to know and you are sincere in wanting to know, it shall be revealed to you. Mm-hmm. We don't have to go through blindly. We don't have to go through understanding. When I read about some of the stories of the persecutions and tribulations of the of before, it tells me that they were being suffering and being treated that way with a smile on the face, with a beautiful countenance. Why? Because the day star had dawned in their hearts, and they knew that in every suffering and persecution and heartache, they were getting closer to the bright and eternal day. They knew this. Has the day star revealed itself in you, in me? Now we get back to verse 21. Let's read that together, and this will be the conclusion. It says, for the prophecy came not in the old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. It's always darkest just before the dawn. Let's humble our hearts and bend our knees and be led to the throne of grace by the inspiration of our Father and our Lord and Savior, Spirit above. Father in heaven, thank you for this opportunity. I pray that your name has been praised and honored and gloried. I pray that I've been allowed to plant a little seed, dear Father, that will nurture in fertile ground, fertile spiritual ground, that'll cause each and every one of us to grow, that cause each and every one of us to prioritize even more so than we already have the preciousness of the most precious thing that we have, and that is time itself. Let your spirit rest rule and abide in our hearts. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus, we pray, dear Father, let us say, Amen.
Amen.